when I think about playing and what it's all about, it's a big difference in a way, isn't it?
Shall I tell you about my life? They say I'm a man of the world. I've flown across every tide. I've seen lots of pretty girls.
It was an incredibly short run, and yet we're still talking about it nearly 40 years or so later. That's interesting.
I guess I've got everything I need. I wouldn't ask for, and there's no one I'd rather be.
Can't ignore the name Peter Green, you know, and Peter has not given up, and Peter has not gone away, and Peter won't go away.
In San Francisco.
But then I was the first one to take it, and then I started preaching it to the others.
And it's with the Grateful Dead.
Falling, you kind of fall, like faint, you encounter it.
He was always sensitive to the other side.
I was always told it was six, and it was the sixth one that did it.
This is someone who's in a lot of trouble. We all dutifully went the same way, except he didn't fully recover from that journey.
I could tell you about my life.
I don't blame what happened to Peter Green on LSD or anything. It's all about finding that peace within yourself.
There's quite a large resentment about these people that actually did that to him.
How I don't want to be sad anymore. And how I wish I was in love.
I actually interviewed B.B. King. He said that the only guitarist that sent shivers down his spine was Peter Green.
I think Peter's voice became almost more important than his guitar playing in many ways. And it was totally, there was a realness to it.
To me, I like him more for his songwriting than his guitar playing. His guitar playing is, without question, he's without question the best British blues guitarist ever.
Need someone's hand to lead me through the night. I need someone's arms to hold and squeeze me tight.
Peter in his prime in the 60s was just without equal. I mean, it was a force to be reckoned with.
I'm out of air because I need your love so bad. I need some lips to feel next to mine.
This is 18 antenna house, E2, old Bethnal Green Road, E2. And that's where I used to live, that number 18 there.
When Peter was 10, my brother Lenny, the older brother, was having lessons on a guitar. And he found out later he was tone deaf, so he decided that it wasn't for him. So he gave the guitar to Peter, but showed him three chords, E, A and B7.
Well, after about, I suppose, 6 to 8 months, Peter was doing really well. And I said to him, Mum, is that little son got my record player on up there? I can hear it. And it was him playing.
Peter honed his guitar skills listening to the early skiffle bands. By the time he was 18, he had already played stints with Pete B's Lunas and Shotgun Express. But Peter was increasingly drawn towards the new burgeoning blues scene.
John Mayall was one of these bands, of course, that played ethnic blues and kind of stuck with it. and people came in and out of his band. He was always had an eye for a really good musician, and particularly a good guitarist. And his first one, of course, that everybody knew about was Eric Clapton. On one occasion, Eric had left the band. This must have been about 64, I guess. And his replacement was Peter Green.
Well, he was one of the many candidates who put their names forward for the job of replacing Eric when Eric cleared off to Greece on that abortive effort of the glands or whatever that was. But Peter was a lot better than any of the ones I'd been trying out already, and he was very persistent. And so, you know, ultimately I gave him a shot at it.
The lead guitarist spot in the Blues Breakers was the most coveted in Britain, wasn't it? You know, any Tom, Dick and Harry can be an Oasis, you know what I mean, as long as you've got the right haircut.
When John Mayall went for the first recording session with Peter, walked into the studio, and I think Mike Vernon, who was the producer at the time, noticed that there was a different amplifier amongst the setup in the studio, and sort of said, whose is that then? And he said, oh, we've got a new guitarist, you know, we've got rid of Eric. Oh my God, you know, what do you mean you've got rid of Eric? You know, this one's much better, said John Mayall. Much better than Eric Clapton.
My God, you know, who have you found that could possibly be better than that? So I didn't know Peter Green. Very affable guy, you know, very quiet. And I thought, well, he's going to have to be pretty damn good if he's going to fill Eric's footsteps. Well, from the moment that Peter plugged in the Les Paul and started playing, I never had any doubt that he was going to be as good as Eric within the Blues Breaker framework, but different. And I think that was the secret. That was the secret. I think John already knew he could play all the licks, he could do all the things that Eric could do, but he wasn't going to do. He was going to do his way.
I think Peter had a hard time convincing the audience of his integrity and his power, because people were all, you know, dead set on hearing Eric with the band, you know.
Around this time, Eric had become God, you know, along with the graffiti on the walls, you know, Eric is God, you know, we want God, we want God. I seem to recall going up at one stage and get off Big Nose, I can even recall. And poor Peter suffered a bit of this abuse, but gradually I think he won them over, because it was pretty obvious that, you know, he was a great guitarist.
People took to Peter, you know, after a few where's Eric, you know, or whatever. Eric's God. It wasn't too long after that it was the Green God.
That did lead to you know, the doing the Hard Road album, and by that time Ainsley Dunbar was the drummer, and McVie was still the bass player, so it was a very powerful unit.
Well, the very first time I met Peter was in the studio when we did the Hard Road album. I mean, I certainly don't remember ever having met him prior to that. My memories are he had a little joke here and there, you know, and you could see there was he had a character. But the thing that mattered the most was the way he played.
The Supernatural was something that Peter got together on his own, and we just kind of stood by and just accompanied him on that one. The way of recording back then was only on four tracks, so there was a lot of layers that he put on it, you know, where he overdubbed different octaves of the same tune and built up a very haunting piece.
And not only did he make the very best of it as a guitar player, but he also showed, unlike Eric, who was very quiet and very subdued about his ability as a singer, Peter, no doubt whatsoever. You don't love me, baby.
You don't love me, yes, I know. Peter enjoyed playing with John McVie, but John Mayall thought drummer Ainsley Dunbar was getting far too technical. Peter seemed to have a hand in recruiting Mick Fleetwood, his old drummer from the Lunars.
I joined John Mayall